Hello everyone, I'm Suman Nova, Physical Education Director, Prep School, Bhai Vidyashram. I'll be handling the subject Health and Physical Education. In today's class, I'll be discussing on the third session of 12th chapter, that is Training in Sports. Before I start, I would like to give a small recap on what are the things which we learned in the previous two classes. In previous class, we learned about what is the meaning of training. We also learned about the fitness components which an individual should have to excel in the field of sports. Later on, we learned about four fitness components, that is strength, endurance, speed, and flexibility. Coming to the strength part, we learned the types of strength and methods to improve strength. Next, endurance. We learned the types of endurance and methods to improve endurance. Then, speed. We learned the types of speed and methods to improve speed. At last, we learned about flexibility, types of flexibility, and methods to improve flexibility. And in today's class, we are going to learn about the next physical fitness component, that is coordinative ability. Before 1980, speed, strength, flexibility and agility were considered as the main physical fitness components. But after that, the concept agility was changed into coordinative ability. Coordinative ability mainly depends on the central nervous system of an individual. Coordinative ability is the ability of an individual to do various related activity properly and effectively. Our accuracy, rhythm, flow, and concentration depends on the coordinative ability which we have. The coordinative ability helps the sportsman to do group of activity in a perfect way. The learning speed of an individual depends on the coordination ability which he has. Now we have learned about what is coordinative ability. Coming to the types of coordinative ability, we have seven types. They are orientation ability, coupling ability, reaction ability, balance ability, rhythmic ability, adaptation ability, and differentiation ability. Now let's see in detail about these abilities. The first type of coordination ability is orientation ability. Orientation ability is the ability of an individual to determine the position of body or part of body in time and space in relation to gravity and moving objects like ball, partner, opponent, and even the playing surface. This ability depends on the functional capacity of sensory organs. The example which we can give is eyes. Now let's see the next type of coordinative ability, that is coupling ability. Coupling ability is the ability of an individual to combine different movements of body parts and make a perfect sports movement. The best example which we can give for this coupling ability is boxing. In this event, the individual will have to use his head, shoulder, waist, and leg to execute many skills. So, this coupling ability is required in many of the sports related activities. Now let's see the next type of ability, that is reaction ability. Reaction ability is the ability of an individual to react for the given signal immediately or quickly. In reaction ability, we have two types, that is simple reaction ability and complex reaction ability. Simple reaction ability is that ability in which the signal which we are going to receive is predetermined. The best example which we can give is a gunshot in 100 meter race. Coming to the second type of reaction ability, it is complex reaction ability. In this type of reaction ability, the signal which we are going to receive is not predetermined. It comes on the spot. The best example is a batsman waiting for the ball to get delivered. He should play according to the ball which he gets. If he gets a short ball, he has to play a particular shot. If he gets a bouncer, he has to play in a different way. So this is all about reaction ability. The next type of coordinative ability is balance ability. It is the ability to maintain balance with complete body movement and regain balance after balance disturbing movement. It can also be defined as the ability to control the body position either in static position or while moving. The next type of coordinative ability is rhythmic ability. It is the ability of an individual to observe the rhythm of that activity and do that activity with required rhythm. We can see this type of rhythmic ability in many of the sporting activities. The best example is rowing, in which they have to act rhythmically to get the best performance. The next type of coordination ability is adaptation ability. Adaptation ability is the ability of an individual to adjust or change in the moment effectively with the change in the situation. I would like to give a small example on this adaptation ability. We can see a spiker changing the direction of the ball after the blocker approaches the ball. So, by this example, we can easily understand that it is the ability to change the movement with the situation, if the situation demands for it. And the last type of coordination ability is differentiation ability. The high level of accuracy depends on the experience of the individual and mastering over that motor ability. Here we see a woman putting a three-pointer. When we are doing this type of activity, this differentiation ability works for us. Now we have learned about types of coordinative ability. Now let's see the next topic, that is high altitude training. This type of training is done mostly for the endurance runners. In this type of training, the individuals will be made to do the workout at a higher place. If the individual does the workout 500 feet above the sea level, there will be a moderate improvement in the performance. If the individual does the workout 800 feet above the sea level, then his performance will be more compared to 500 feet above the sea level. In this type of training, we have three concepts, that is live high and train high. In this type of training, the individual will be given an accommodation at a higher place, that is at high altitude place, and the training also takes place in that place itself. So this technique is not highly recommended by the experts. Coming to the second concept, that is live low and train high. This is the concept which many of the people suggest, wherein the individuals will be accommodated in a lower height compared to the place where they are doing the workout. In this type, we can expect some improvement in the performance of an individual. Coming to the next type, that is live high and train low. This type of training can be used for the people who do the activities between 8 minutes to 20 minutes, which includes the events like 3000 meters, 5000 meters, etc. So this type is more beneficiary for the events which come under 8 minutes to 20 minutes. Now let's see the impacts of high altitude training on the individuals. We have both positive and negative impacts. First, let's see the positive impacts of this high altitude training. The first advantage of this type of training is it decreases the supply of oxygen for muscles. When the individual gets less oxygen for muscles, it will be a difficult task for him to do the workout. If he adjusts for that type of training, he will be able to give very good performance when he comes down to normal sea level. This is the theory behind that. Coming to the next point, that is, when the individual does high altitude training, he naturally builds a hormone called erythropoietin. It is also called EPO, which helps in the increase of red blood cells in the blood. So, by increasing the red blood cells in the blood, we can supply more oxygen for muscles. By providing more oxygen to muscles, we can expect more performance by an individual. This type of training also helps in the physiological aspects. The number of small blood vessels will increase and the capacity to manage accumulation of waste acid also increases. Coming to the disadvantages of this type of training is, the first negative impact of this type of training is, it is very difficult for an individual to get set for this altitude level. It will be not easy for the individual to get that level of atmosphere. The next disadvantage is, due to the increase in red blood cells, the blood becomes thicker and it will be difficult for the blood to flow. And it becomes very difficult for the heart to pump the blood throughout the body. So when this happens, the blood will not be able to reach all the parts of the body to supply oxygen. Coming to the next disadvantage, that is, we cannot avoid loss of muscles in this type of training. When we start this type of training, the metabolism automatically starts using the muscle for the source of energy. By this type of training, our body immune system also will go down. In this place, we cannot do any intensive training. So, it might later on result in low performance of an athlete. These are the disadvantages which we find after implementing this high altitude training. And to conclude, I'll recap what are the things which we learned in this chapter, that is training in sports. First, we learned about what is training, the physical fitness components which an individual should have to excel in sports. We learned 5 physical fitness components, that is strength, endurance, speed, flexibility and coordination. At last, we learned about high altitude training. These are the things which we learned in this chapter. To conclude, fitness is everyone's dream, but it all starts with a good intention of achieving successful result. And that successful result starts with the first step of training. Thank you.